with today's session. Just a quick overview. We discussed about the linear regression, right? So in the last week we discussed about what is linear regression once again in detail. Why do we need to use linear regression, right? So linear regression is used to fit a straight line, right? Or linear regression is nothing but using which we are solving the regression problem. What do you mean by regression problem? In simple term, predicting a target variable which is of a numeric data type. That's all.
Satya, your voice is not clear actually, and I don't go to get some echo.
One second. Echo sound is there? Okay, let me do one thing. So how about now? Is it okay? Hello?
Not in echo, when you are close to the mic.
I think I'm not close to the mic. This mic, right, requires me to talk very closer to it. Is it clear now? I think it is clear now. No. No or yes?
Fine.
I think some background noise because of that. Better, right? Okay. Fine. So we discussed about the linear regression, right? What is linear regression at a high level, right? We discussed about what is linear regression. Using linear regression, we can make a prediction or forecasting. You can do it, or you can estimate the target outcome variable, right? You can estimate the target outcome variable. I have explained you with the real estate data set, right? With that data set, I explained you, which all features that we can use it to make a prediction with that example, right? So I'll just go back quickly, and the size of the house and number of bedrooms and parking lot and other data, right? So using which we use those features, we can predict the or estimate the target variable, which is nothing but the housing price. And also we discussed about what is the intercept and what is slope, right? So intercept is nothing but the value of x, when the value of x equal to 0, what is the average value of y? Screen is not visible. I think now it is better, right?
Yeah, I can see your screen now.
Good. One second here. Yeah, we discussed about what is intercept. Intercept is nothing but the straight line which crosses the y-axis. See, the as the name suggests, linear regression. What is linear? Which is nothing but straight line. So, right, this is a straight line. We are fitting a straight line to our data, right? So we are fitting a straight line to our data. So that is why they call it as a linear regression. We discussed about the intercept and slope. Intercept, as I told you, the line which crosses the y-axis is called your intercept. From the business point of view, intercept is helpful in terms of estimating the average value or quantifying the average estimated value of y when the value of x equal to 0, right? As I told you, intercept is a constant value. It is not always meaningful, right? It depends on the problem that you solve, right? Or domain, depends on the domain that you solve the regression problem. The intercept depends on the domain, or depends on the domain when you use the linear regression model, right? For some domain, the intercept gives you some meaningful interpretation, and some domain it will not be meaningful, right? So that's what we discussed it. What is slope? Slope is nothing but the estimated y changes by the slope for each 1 unit increase in x. That means what is the value of y, or what is the rate of change in y when x changes? What is the rate of change in y when x changes? What is y? take example of this one, the housing price. What is X? X is nothing but the size of the house. As the size increases, the price also increases, right? Obviously, to 500 square feet, 1000 square feet, 1600 square feet, as the size increases, the housing price also increases. Supposing your manager wants to know, or if he asks you a question like, so what if I increase 1 square feet? What is the change in my housing price? If he asks you, right, then you can quantify with the help of slope. With the help of slope, you can quantify it. Supposing, let's say your slope is 2, your slope is 2, we can tell him very clearly, if there is a 1 unit increase in the square feet, there is, you know, the housing price will increase 2 times, right? 2 times of that value, right? 2 for each 1 unit, right? The housing price will increase by 2 for each 1 square feet. That is how we need to interpret. That's where the slope is very much helpful. So using the linear regression model, one of the key objectives of the linear regression model is fitting the line, best fit line, right? So OLS, using linear regression uses OLS method, ordinary least squares method. Linear regression model uses ordinary least squares method in order to identify the best fit line. What do you mean by identifying the best fit line? So as I told you, this line should not be biased. If you move this line little up, or if you move this line little down, these values will be, if you shift this line from here to, you know, to little bit downward, these values will be very closer to this line, but whereas these values will be too far for this line, right? If you draw a line here instead of here, if you move it down little bit, this value will be too far. Similarly, if you shift this, you know, above, little above, right? Or, you know, if you draw a line here, what will happen? These values will be closer to this one, these values will not be closer. So the best fit line is nothing but, the best fit line is identified in such a way as close to as many data points as possible. Okay. So, and also we discussed about what is error. What is error? Can someone tell me quickly? Error is also called as a residual. And what is an error? So what is this line? What is this brown color tells us? What is the blue color? What is blue circle and what is brown circle? Anybody? Karthik?
Blue is actual.
Exactly.
Brown is predicted.
Yeah. So this line, on top of this line, the predicted values will be there. See, this is very important. See, Python, R and also, right, you can learn it from the net. Lot of videos nowadays are available. Lot of free materials also available. Videos are also available. The algorithms are very important, okay? So, all the predicted values will be plotted, will be available on top of this line, right? See, usually when you look at this, that's why I showed you in the last session. See, can we view it in terms of the tables, table format? I'll just, you know, write it in table format. One second, there is a loose connection here. Load up. See, same thing. See, this is my unit sales or salesperson. See, in this case, you wanted to predict the number of salespersons, how many number of salespersons that are needed in terms of selling. Supposing your manager is asking you, hey, to sell 200, 650 items, how many number of salespersons are required? How many number of salespersons that I have to recruit? Right? So here by looking at it, just by drawing a line, right? And if you draw a line to touch this line, and if you draw in parallel to this one, right? Yeah, so you can tell him close to 8 people, right? 5, 6, 7, 8. So to sell 650 units of the items, the estimated salespersons are 8. We need 8 people to be deployed, right? 8 people are deployed. This is how we can tell. So now let's let's take for example in this case, right? Housing price in the x-axis we have size of the house, 200 square feet and 400 square, something like that, right? So here the price is in terms of crores, 2 crores, 5 crores or 10 crores, something like that, housing price. So here the actual value, for example, your manager has given you, he has given you the data, something like size and price. Listen very carefully. It's not like learning other domain. Your concentration is very much important. Don't get diverted even for a minute. Estimated price. And then this is called your error. Okay. What is the size of the house, price of the estimated price? So size of the house is 200 square feet. And 400 square feet and 600. These are the data already given, right? The price is 0.5 crore, 1 crore, 2 crore, something like that, okay? Or something like that, okay? The estimated price is somewhat closer to this one. Or let's say, I'll do one thing, 100, 200, 300, okay? The estimated price is 99 and this is 200, 300. 200 is, let's say the estimated price is 199. And the estimate is here 300, right? So 310. Now what is the error? Can someone tell me what is actual, what is error? What we want to predict is, we want to predict the housing price, right? Actual, this is the values given by my manager. These two values were given by manager. With that I trained my model, and then I wanted to estimate the housing price for the given data, okay, using my model, linear regression model, okay. So the estimated price, I got it for this square feet as 99. My linear regression model, for this size, it estimated the housing price is 99 and 199 and 310. This is actual. What is this? What is this value? Sarnath, actual, what is it? What is this?
Estimated
or predicted value, right? Estimated or predicted value. So actual minus predicted is nothing but error. Very simple here. Actual minus predicted is very error. 1, right? So 100 minus 99 is 1. Now you tell me what is the value for this or not. This is 200. Hello. Actual minus
predicted. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yeah. I can hear you, Sarnath. Yeah.
One,
right? Yeah,
one.
Super. Yeah. So next, Karthik, you tell me what is the value here. This is 300.
Minus 10,
super, right? So this is the actual and this is the predicted. The predicted values are, these predicted values are lying on top of this line. That's what visually we can see. The actual price is this one, right? So the actual price need not be same as the predicted price, isn't it? There is an error, right? So in this case, the actual price is this one. The predicted value is here. The actual minus the predicted. Predicted, right? Actual minus predicted is called your error. Error 1. This is called your error 1. Similarly, it not necessarily it has to be positive. Supposing the actual price is 100, the predicted value is 99, then the error is positive 1. In this case, the actual value is 300. Let's that way. The actual value is 300. The predicted value is 310. Overestimated, right? So what is the difference? This is my actual minus predicted. This is my predicted. 300 minus 310 is my minus 10. This is the error. So next, what we will do is, we square this error squared. Why we need to square it? In standard deviation, we square the values, right? So 1 squared is 1, 1 squared is 1. minus 10 into minus 10, minus into minus will become plus, 10 into 10 is 100. We need to add all these values, 102. For this line, the error is, this is square error, right? Sum of square error. Sum of, for all the, for I equal to 1n, all the records, these three records, the sum of all the errors, you know, square error is 102. This is called your sum of squared error. What is the sum of squared error value? 102, right? Sum of squared error. And we have something called root mean squared. And also we have a metric called mean squared error. You take the mean value of this one, 102, right? So 102 divided by 3. How much you will get? 34, right? Mean squared error is 34. And we have another matrix called RMSC. What are these metrics? These are called metrics, SSC, MSC, RMSC. You take the square root of 34, how much you will get? Almost, you know, 5 point some value, right? 5.4. You need to take the square root of this one, right? Which is nothing but root mean squared error. Mean squared error, which is nothing but the square root of this one. Root mean squared error is nothing, probably 5.4. So these are called your metrics. Using these metrics, we evaluate our model. So these data are given by manager, size and price given by manager. With once I fit the model in R or Python, it gives me the estimated or predicted values. Once you know the predicted value, you can find out the error. By subtracting the predicted value from the actual, you can get the error. The error should be very low. The lesser the error, better the accuracy of your model. Okay, lesser the error, the better the accuracy of the model. See, your manager already gave you 100, but when you go back and tell him, no, as per my machine learning linear regression model, after I did lot of fine tuning, I get the estimated housing price is going to be 99. So what you will think, okay, just, well, you know, the only one, and the value one is difference is there, fine. So only one is difference is there, it's a bit negligible. And supposing you get minus 10, or if you, instead of this, right, for example, you have three, actual value is 300, the predicted value is, let's, you know, 200. The difference is 100. As per your record, you sold it at the cost of 300, whereas your model predicted this one as 200, under estimation. There should not be any over estimation, there should not be any under estimation, right? So always make sure that my model predicted values are optimal. This one is supposed to be closer to this one. Ideally, these two are same. These two are supposed to be same. Okay, 100, but in real time scenario, you cannot get same, right? The predicted value will not be exactly same as him. There are some cases, yes, the predicted value actual will be same, but not all the cases it will be same. But if the error, right, using these metrics, we will decide, okay, whether the error is acceptable or not. Right? So now what I did here is, you know, I have taken only one feature here to fit my model or to train my linear regression model. With that I got the predicted values here. Okay, with this I got the predicted values. But what if I add another column, size, and I have something else called age of the house. As you include more independent variable or the features, right, that can help to explain your outcome variable much better. So though they see this variable, the size or the variable should be linearly correlated with this one. As I discussed in the last session, each independent variable should be linearly correlated with your dependent variable, right? So let's say the size is linearly correlated with price, very good. But still, if you have another feature that is also linearly correlated, somewhat linearly correlated with price, also good. To include in the model, right? So that with the combination of these two variables, it can explain the target outcome variable in a much better way. You understood, right? Listen very carefully. Okay, after including the age feature in this machine learning model, let's say my sum of squared error is just 0.83. After including age of those along with size, features, right? These two independent variables, I passed it as an argument to my linear regression model function, and this is the dependent variable. I pass this in dependent variable. Okay, so after including a new variable, additional variable, additional feature in the model, the error, the mean squared error or sum of squared error, or let's say the mean squared error, I'm getting it as 0.83. But here the mean squared error is how much? 34, right? Oh, okay. It's not 34. Let's say 25, right? So 25 or 16. Let's say 16. When you take root mean squared, the error is going to be 4 only. Lesser the RMSE, lesser the mean squared error, lesser this SSE, better the model. See, anybody can build a model, right? So after they say, hey, I developed a linear regression model, the first question which comes to our mind is, as our manager, what question you will ask? They say in your team, 5 people are there, they use the same data set, they predicted it. Some says, hey, according to my model, the predicted value is 99. Or somebody says, no, it is 92. Somebody says, no, 100. Then how will you judge whose model is good? You should have some kind of metrics, right?
Yeah.
So you need to have some metrics. You need to have some metrics, right? Using this metrics, you can validate the accuracy of the model. Lesser the mean squared error or lesser the root mean squared error, the better the model. Let's say three people are there. 1, 2, 3. One guy's root mean squared error is, let's say 5. Another guy's thing is, let's say 4. And this guy's thing is, right, 2. Lesser the error, the better the model. Simple. Yeah, see, your manager asks you to estimate how many number of people are required to develop a website. Let's say you say, this is your actual, right? You are saying, hey, I need 15 people, right? And then after you developed a website, right? You predicted you need 15 people, right? What is the actual? After you developed the website, you realized we don't need a 15 people, it's a static website. It requires hardly 5 people. That means 10 people you park in this project, blindly. They were completely idle, right? The error, your error is very high. Actually, 5 people only needed. After developing the website, you realized only 5 people are required, whereas you need to compare, right? After you need to compare the predicted with actual. This is nothing but the estimated value. Can you give me an estimation? Resource estimation, manager will ask, right? Effort estimation. If you say 15 upfront, and then once you develop the website, and you will record the data, how many people actually we require to develop the 5, then you will think, right, the estimation is wrong because the error is too high, right? So 10, the difference is 2, 10, the difference between actual and predicted is too high. Hope you understood, right? So these are the metrics we use: sum of squared error, mean squared error. These are the other thing. So now the question is, okay, age and size, these two variables are helpful in terms of bringing down my error. Likewise, how many number of features can I include? Right? How many number of features can I include? Or how many number of features can I exclude in real-time scenario? Let's say you are given 32 features. Right? So you need to find out which all features that needs to be included in this one. See, in this case, it is fine. You can use correlation matrix, using which you can find out which all variables are correlated with my target variable. Those variables are correlating with my target variable very well, you include it. There are some variables, right? 0.4 and the correlation. What is correlation? How many of you remember we use a notation R, right? The values are ranging between -1 and +1. We discussed about positive correlation, negative correlation, everything, right? So how do you find out visually the relationship between two independent variables? in the interview they'll ask you, how do you find out the relationship between two independent variables? You will use a scatter plot, right? Scatter plot. This is the visualization we'll be using it to find out the relationship between two variables. Or we can use something called correlation coefficient. What is the formula for correlation coefficient? X minus X bar, Y minus Y bar, divided by even one second. I don't want to make any mistake. The square root of X minus X bar. Okay, one second, let me, I think I mentioned in the subsequent, okay, no, let me just, so we have something called, coefficient, x minus x bar into y minus y bar divided by square root of, oh, I discarded it, right? X minus x bar and y minus y bar divided by square root of x minus x bar whole square into y minus y bar whole square. See, I intentionally went here. I remember very well. The reason why, if I do search, at least now it will get registered in your mind. All these formulas, everything is available here, okay, in this document. Let me do one thing. Right, so the, yeah, next we wanted to understand how to do feature selection. This is also one of the key tasks that you need to do as a data scientist. We need to be judicious in terms of identifying the features that are relevant to fit my model. Okay, so we are how do we select the best set of features or subset of the predictors or the features, right? You need to identify the redundant predictors. I don't want to have the same features to be repeated, right? I need to remove, if I have similar thing, I can remove it. And also including more number of features than required in my model can also increase the noise. Noise in the sense, error, right? Noise is nothing but error. It can cause error, okay? And then there should not be any collinearity. There should not be any correlation amongst the independent variable. Yeah, there should not be any correlation amongst the variable. Okay, the next one is, if the model is to be used for prediction, we can save time and money by not measuring redundant predictors. Okay, exclude the redundant features and include only the relevant features. In case of any collinearity amongst the independent variable, then also it will cause problem. Okay, so we will discuss about collinearity little later, don't worry. Okay, and also identify the outliers and influential points, right? Exclude them at least temporarily. So these are the steps that we carry out as a data scientist to improve the model accuracy. So instead of doing it manually, as I told you, so we have, the customer gave us 100 features. 100 features. Features are nothing but the columns, right? 100 columns are there. So how do I know which all columns that I need to listen in column 1, age of the person and marital status and his email ID, first name, last name, right? And his mobile number, contact number. And age, income, and you have something called other demographic details like marital status, number of children. Likewise, many columns are there. Right? So first name, last name, why do I need it? I don't need it. First of all, to fit a linear regression model, both your independent and dependent variables should be a numerical variables. You should not have any character or string variables like the first name, last name. It is, see, you tell me how come a customer first name will be helpful in terms of predicting the housing price. Today house is owned by Satya, tomorrow the same house will be used by Akbar or Abdul or somebody else, right? When the customer purchases an house, he will be asking about the size of the house and like that, right? They never worry about who is living in the house and all, right? So the first name, like these variables are irrelevant. Email is not relevant, mobile is not relevant, marital status is also not available when it comes to housing price, right? Age of the house is required. Income, forget about income, or this is for some other thing, okay? So include only the relevant features. But in my given data set, I have 100 features. So manually finding out which all variables are helpful to predict the model, right? It is a painful job. So we have something called the stepwise regression is available. There is something called step function. There is called something called step function, parenthesis, step function available in R. Unfortunately, it is not available in Python. It is a built-in function, but once you understand the concept, you can write a simple function to implement the same in Python also, right? So in R, we have something called backward stepwise regression and forward stepwise regression. As the name suggests, right, you start with all the, you include all the features in the model, and then you will check whichever variables p value is high, those variables you will remove it, right, and refit the model and go to step two, stop and see. It's very simple, okay? There is something called p value, right? We discussed about p value, right? P value is less than alpha. What is this? What do you do in statistics? We discussed p is less than alpha. What do you do? See, this is a universal rule. Even if you do PhD in data science or statistics, this will not change. Even if you study in Harvard or any university, the rule is same. P is less than alpha, what you will do? What is p value? It's a probability, right? What is the alpha? Significance value. You remember we discussed about 0.05, right? 0.05, and p value is less than this one. What we do? We reject the null hypothesis. That means these variables are, that means when it comes to feature selection, whichever variables p value is less than alpha, we reject the null hypothesis. That means including that variable in my model will help improving my accuracy, or that variable is helpful in terms of explaining my outcome variable. In other words, including, see, the whichever variable, for example, the age of the house, the model automatically give you the p value also along with this. The p value is 0.002. obviously the 0.002 is less than 0.05. that means you reject the null hypothesis. What is null hypothesis? Null hypothesis, age is not a significant variable. Since the p value is less than alpha, we reject that and we conclude that age is a significant variable, statistically significant. That means this variable is very much helpful in terms of predicting the housing price. Hence you include this variable in your model, okay? And this p value, right, it automatically does this backward step. We don't have to manually check, okay, I have 100 variables, which variables p value, which all variables p value is less than alpha, which all variables p value is greater than alpha, those variables p value is less than alpha, I need to include. You don't have to break your head. It automatically recommends you the model, with the features that are statistically significant. Hey, include age, automatically gives you. I'll show you in R. R is very much helpful in that case, okay? That's why R and Python, most of them, they say Python is good always. Both of them has its own positive and advantages and disadvantages. So age and age of the house, size of the house, likewise it tells you all the features that are significant, and it automatically eliminates those variables are not helpful to predict your housing price. So in the case of backward step, you include all the variables, 100 features they are given you, blindly include all the 100 features and leave it with the step function, right? Close your eyes and wait for some time. Once you specify all the columns and the dependent variable name, that's it, it will take care. After few seconds, it will tell you the features it will recommend you with the feature names. Hey, use these features. So behind the scene, how it works? So how it eliminates the features? It eliminates the features with the highest p value. P value is greater than alpha, then you fail to reject the null hypothesis. That means those variables are non-significant. Then what is the point in including my model? In simple terms, this is what is happening by itself. Next one is forward stepwise regression. It will start with no variables, and then it keep add one after the another features. First, it will build a model with no independent variable, and then it will start include size, and then it will include age of the house, plus it will include the area of the house. Right? Gradually, it will include the features one after the another. So you also right, it will check for the p value after adding the value, new features, right? It will get the p value. Choose the one with the lowest p value less than alpha value until new predictors can be added. Right, it will keep on check, right, by adding which variables are good. Here also it uses the same thing, p value only. The p value is less than alpha, it will include it, keep included, otherwise it will not include it. So the one drawback with this one is because of the one at a time nature of adding dropping value, it is possible to miss the optimal model. Which one? The forward stepwise regression. The p values you should not be treated too literally. The removal of less significant predictors tends to increase the significance of the remaining predictors. This the effect leads one to overstate the importance of the remaining predictors. This I will explain a little later. If I explain everything now, you will get confused. At this moment, you just keep in mind you have a mechanism to perform feature selection in R. We have a function called step function. In Python also, there is something called there is a package available. Okay, so using which also you can do feature selection. When I show you while implementing the model in Python, right? I will show you. I'll explain you that one. Okay. So first of all, you need to understand, right? Or let's say customer gave you, or your manager gave you 100 columns. Just because he gave you 100 columns, you cannot simply include all the 100 columns to train your model. All those 100 features may not be helpful to predict your target variable. You need to identify the subset of the columns, which columns that I have to use it to train my model. If you have less number of columns, you can use correlation matrix. By looking at the correlation matrix itself, you can tell when it comes to linear regression. These features are linearly correlated with my target outcome variable, hence I can go ahead with this. But if you have 100 columns, looking at the correlation matrix, it is a painful thing, right? So it will take, it's a time consuming job, hence you can rely on stepwise regression. So as I told you, we use metrics like mean, absolute error, mean squared error, root mean squared error. We use something like mean absolute percentage error, or we say something like RMSLE, right? So apart from this, something called adjusted R squared, right? Adjusted R squared, and we use these metrics to evaluate how best our model is doing it. What are these metrics? These metrics are specific to linear regression model. These metrics are specific to linear regression. So why should I use these metrics? Can't I use only one matrix? Yes, you can use RMSE itself, or you can use mean squared error, or you can use anything. But in the industry, and also this is very much helpful. Adjusted R-squared is very much helpful. Adjusted R-squared and RMSE, that is more than sufficient. The reason why I mention all these things are, you will have to face the interview, right? Interviewer, they may ask you anything. They may ask you what is sum of squared error, what is mean absolute error, right? What is ordinal least squares method? Linear regression uses ordinal least square method in order to identify the best fit line. That is what? Ordinary least squares method, right? how the ordinary least square method identify the best fit line? By estimating the optimal value for the intercept and slope, right? By estimating the optimal value for the intercept and slope, right? It ensures that it fits the straight line. It fits the straight line. So you know the equation, right? So we know the equation y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 into x. Simple linear regression. For example, this is my intercept. This is my slope. I told you the intercept and slope are computed by my model automatically. Okay, how does this estimate? If I put tap on top of this, that means estimated value of the intercept and estimated value of the slope is done by ordinary least squares method. So by estimating the optimal value for the intercept and slope, it makes sure that it is fitting the best fit line, right? In the last session I discussed about intercept. Intercept is meaningless in some use cases. I gave you the auto fire example. So in this case, let's say my intercept is 20 and my slope is 2, and if I travel 100 kilometers, what is the estimated auto fare? This is my 100 kilometers. To travel 100 kilometers, what is the estimated auto fare? Let's say in the case of Uber, right? He predicts the auto fare. Let's say you wanted to estimate 0 kilometers, you are not traveling. 2 into 0 is 0. And even if you don't travel, the estimated average auto fare is 20. Even if you don't travel, now don't say it's a minimum fare. Even if you don't travel, when you travel, you are supposed to pay. Even if you travel for half kilometer or less than half kilometer, so there is a minimum fare, but you are not at all traveling. If you ask you to pay 20 rupees, will you accept? In this case, the intercept is meaningless. But can I remove the intercept here? See, in this case, it is not meaningful. Can I remove this? If I remove this, what will happen? If I remove intercept, what will happen? What will happen? How many of you remember?
Start from zero.
Exactly. This is my zero, right? This line will originate from here. See, this is the best fit line according to my model, but the line will go something like this. Or if the line goes something like this, it will start to originate from zero. The line will go somewhere here, but actually the estimated line is, best fit line is this, but your line goes up. The line goes up, what will happen? The error will be more, right? You will have error. See, this is the predicted line, right? All the predicted values sit on this top of this line. Your actual value is here, predicted value is here. But if you make the intercept zero, this line will get shifted here. If that gets shifted, this value and the predicted values are too far, right? Too far. Similarly, for the other thing also, right? The predicted value is too far. So you have to include your intercept, no matter whether it is meaningful or meaningless. You have to include that one here. Okay. This is what we discussed. So intercept and slope we discussed, and so we have something adjusted R square. So this one you understood. I see the interview, they'll ask you all these terms. You should be able to explain them. And this one, they'll ask you these kind of questions also, right? Why should I include intercept? Can't I exclude the intercept? Okay. So as I told you, these are the metrics we use it to estimate the model accuracy. So I will just give you an analogy, right? So for example, when a person is sick or not, how can a doctor can evaluate him whether he is healthy person or unhealthy person? He will check his pulse. If his pulse is 72, 80 or 84, he is a normal person. His heart is good. If his heart rate is 100 and above, then something wrong. If his heart rate is less than 60, for heart rate, they use heart rate as a metric. They use blood pressure as a metric, right? And plus there are other metrics, heart rate, blood pressure, sugar, right? All these metrics, they are the parameters they use it to evaluate whether the person is fit enough or not, right? And also temperature, body temperature, everything, right? Similarly, to evaluate how well my model's accuracy, right, we use these metrics, RMSE or RMSE. Usually we use RMSE, okay, and adjusted R-squared also we will be using it. I will show you what all these things, okay, how to use all the things, okay, and also what is the rational for R-squared, adjusted R-squared. So in addition to using these metrics, you should validate your linear regression model using the regression assumptions. Only these metrics are not sufficient. Like heart rate, BP is normal, can you conclude a person is good? His sugar is very high, right? In addition to heart rate and BP, you will check his sugar also. Likewise, in addition to these metrics, you will validate your model with some predefined assumptions. If your model is meeting those assumptions, then, right, your model is doing good. And also you will check any influential observations are there, right, outliers or something like that. In that case, eliminating outlier can also help improving your model accuracy, okay. So now let us quickly jump into the R studio. We'll start with R, okay. R is also very simple one. See, just ignore all these steps, okay. I'll just, you know, import all the necessary packages. I click run, all the packages got imported. The next step is you read a file, read.csv. Now what we will do is we will check, you know, how many number of rows are there in this data set, how many number of columns are there. We will just explore the data. First step is import the data and explore the structure of the data and view the data also. By viewing the structure of the data, you get to know all these features of number data type, hence you don't have to convert. You don't have to do any type conversion. Good. So of these five features, this is the dependent variable. The rest of them are independent variable. Size of the house, undivided share. UDS stands for undivided share. Those of you live in apartment, you know, right? Undivided share and parking lot. MIS is something common area. Common area square feet. Okay. The price of the. So I just took one simple data set. With this, if I fit a model, you will be able to understand very clearly, okay. If I take 100 columns up front and if I do complex transformation and then finally if I show you how to fit the model, you will get confused. So the next one is, okay, I could see that 148 records are there, 5 columns are there, very good. And next I am going to use head function to view the top 6 records. Good. So I could see that the sizes are, you know, there is a, you know, there could be chances that they, you know, there will be some kind of outlier, and UDS, park, MAS, everything is there, fine. And I use something called summary function is available in R. It gives me the 6 number summary or whatever, okay. This one, look here, the minimum is 0.7, the maximum is 296.4, right. So this tells us very clearly there are some outliers out there, right? And then MISE, PAR, all these data we could see that, very good. The next one is exploratory data analysis. This itself, this is also called as exploratory only. We do some kind of, the visualization, whether the target variable is normally distributed or not. It should be normally distributed, okay? It is normally distributed. But this is approximately normally distributed. When I say the target variable is normally distributed, the next question is, what if the target variable is not normally distributed? It need not to be exactly normally distributed, it will be, you know, approximately, even if it is approximately normal, it is okay. Similarly, I'm just using the yeast function to be the size of those. This is also kind of right. There is some kind of ups and downs are there. Okay, we cannot say in the real world, right? You cannot get the exact normal distribution bell curve. This is also fine part. And next, what I'll do is I'll use box plot. So using this one, plot int. So with this simple, the code snippet, right? I plot all these variables in one go, right? In box plot, instead of plotting it one by one, right? Take all the variables and iterate. So look here, the last one is price, right? In this data set,
price. What line number 40 does it?
That we will discuss it. Don't get into too much of technical. I want you to focus on the main point, okay? So this one will, give you 2, 2. So that means row, comma, column, right? Each row display 2 and something like that. Formatting, okay? This one. And at this moment, forget about the technical stuff. I want you to understand the high level activities now, okay? The price. For the price, we use the box plot. If you use this one, right, since we have used loop, it plotted the box plot for all the features. By looking at MISC box plot, we could see that there are some outliers, right? This is your minimum value, this is your maximum value. Anything above the maximum or your outliers. So why do we use box plot? To identify the distribution, whether it is normally distributed or not, like histogram. Box plot also helpful to identify the distribution, and also it is helpful in terms of identifying the outliers. See, price has no outliers, and MISC is outlier, and park also outliers, UDS no outlier, and size also has no outlier. Okay. Similarly, histogram also you can use it, right? That's what I mentioned it here. Hist function. Why to use one by one, right? Let's say you have 25 features. Will you type 25 times hist price, hist size, something like that? You can use a for loop to plot all the numerical features in one go, right? You can use it. Next, I'm going to device off. Okay, div dot off. It will disappear this one. The next one is I want to find out the outlier, right? I want to fix the outlier. There are some outliers. We'll discuss about that one later. And I'm going to use something called car function. This is what I want you to remember. So what is car function does? This is what called as correlation coefficient. The identifying the relationship between the two numerical variable. Right? Using this formula also we can find out the relationship between two variables. For example, UDS and size. There is no correlation exists between size and UDS, right? Correlation value is supposed to be, range of the correlation should be -1 and +1, and in this case UDS and size is the value is 0.07. any value which is closer to 1, that means those two variables are correlated well. Now you tell me, for example, okay, let's take price. Let's look at this is the price, right? Look at this column. This is my dependent variable. I told you one statement, right? All your independent variables are supposed to be linearly correlated with your price, target variable. Okay, so what is the what is this value? Is this related to which variable? How to interpret this one? See, this is the size is size and price. What is the correlation? You specify the strength of the relationship between the size numerical variable and price numerical variable. Your size is the independent variable, price is the dependent variable. So of these values, forget about price. If you correlate price with price, it will be 1 only, right? So hence there is no point in correlating price with price. And now you tell me of these four features, which all variables are highly correlated with price? Size, union, spark, MASE, these four variables. See, horizontally you need to look at it. You need to compare size with price. See, size with size, if you compare it, will be one only. If I compare myself with myself, I will say I am great, right? So size and price, these two are the correlation value. The correlator is 0.80 and UDS is 0.56 and PARC is 0.19, MASE is 0.19. These are the correlated values of the of these independent variables with the price, with the corresponding price dependent variable. So what does it say? See, I discussed about correlation coefficient as part of descriptive statistics.
It's giving kind of a factor like how dependent, how much it is dependent.
Helpful.
Two values.
No, don't say dependent. Yeah, how much? Yeah, you can say that also, right? Yeah.
How based on size, how much price is going to be increased? So it kind of like a B1.
Don't confuse with beta 1 or beta naught. It is nowhere related to intercept or slope. Okay, it is nowhere related to that one.
Okay,
correlation, that means relation. What is the relationship between you and your wife? How well, see, there is a relationship between me and my wife. How strong the relationship? It is 0.80, 0.90 or 0.23 or something like that. The strength of the relationship. I just gave you one simple analogy, don't get me wrong, okay. Hope your family is not around, they will beat me. Right. See, this size is correlated very well with, see, you, let's say you tell your manager, sir, I say this is what your, yeah, instead of talking this now, these correlated values, right, these values I plotted in a chart using car graph. See, I assign this, the output of car housing PDR, right, this one, I assign to variable called housing.car, and I use something called car plot. Okay, I did not use, okay, one second, car plot, yeah, this is what car plot, usually we use car plot only. This one, these values I plotted in a chart, okay, this is called car plot, correlation plot. Using this also you can interpret it. So you need to, how you need to interpret? So you have all the variables plotted here, including price. You need to compare each and every variable with the target variable, housing price. That is the rule, right? In the case of linear regression, all your independent variables are supposed to be linearly correlated with your price. Relationship, right? Correlation. The size and price. So this is the spectrum. If you look at it, so any value, right? The which is so any value or the color, the darker the color, you know, the relationship is very high. So if you look at the price and size, this is my dependent variable, this is my independent variable, right? The size and price, if you compare it, right? So this is for the combination of this. See, don't look at this color. You need to compare the size with the price color. Somewhat here, right? 0.8. And price and UDS is this color vary, you can see. Somewhat you can see here, right? 0.5, something like that. PARC and MISC, what is the color here? See, the darker the color, better the relationship. So here, are these two variables, PARC and MISC, are these two variables colors are darker? Tell me, is this a darker or lighter color?
Lighter.
Lighter, that means there is no relation, not, it's a weak relationship. No relation or weak relationship. There is a very weak relationship with this one. By looking at this itself, we can say these two variables are not correlated with price, the target variable price. Hence, do not include these two variables. Feature selection. Now itself you did the feature selection, right? PARC and MISC is nowhere correlated, hence We can knock off these two variables. Why should I include in my model? This is one way of doing the feature selection. Yes, especially if you have a less number of features given, 10 or 12, you can use this one also. Right? And the UDS is also somewhat correlated with this one, but it is kind of, you know, moderate relationship with this one. See, your manager is asking you, right? Let's, you know, this is me and my wife or my wife, right? You know, what is the, so you guys have good relationship, you know, bit, see, you guys have good relationship, you and your wife have a good relationship. Yes, we have a good relationship. That doesn't mean the relationship is so strong, right? So relationship is moderate. Okay, phone up, auto, all the trigram. Or if I say, no, very strong, so we have very good understanding. You just, you know, relate that, you know, analogy with this one, okay? If you say simply, yes, we have relationship, that is not sufficient. See, you know very well, when we present anything to American customer, they'll ask us to quantify. Okay, there is a relationship. Is there a way you can quantify? Yes. That is where this function is helpful. Correlation function is helpful to quantify the relationship between the numeric variables. So look at the price, right? 0.80. That's what it says. Price and size. Size and price, these two are 0.80. That's the, see, somewhere here, right? Somewhat here, 0.801. So UDS also. So these two variables are not helpful. Do not include it. Fine. The next step, what I'm going to do is I'm creating a training and test data set. In the case of supervised machine learning model, you need to create the training and test set. Don't literally go by the commands, okay? You will get confused. First, understand the big picture. That is what is important now. So now what I do is I have, you know, there is a function in R, create data partition. You take any SAS or Spark or Python, they use different functions, right? But end of the day, the objective is same. Here, what I mentioned, right? Randomly sample 60% of the data from the given data set. Okay? That randomly sampled 60% of data, you store it in a variable called train. The remaining 40% of the data, you store it in a variable called test. As simple as that. Okay, understand the big picture. Don't get into the details now. Okay? So 60%, see, my data frame name is housing DF, right? Housing DF. That is where all these values are there. What I do is I need to create a training and test data set. Why should I create a training and test data set? Using the training data set, I am going to train my model. Once I train my model, I need to validate my model performance on the unseen data. For that, I need a test data set. So for that reason, we create train and test data set. The training data set, I store the 60% of the rank. So you can specify 60%, 70% or 80%. It is up to you. But usually what we do is, we specify 0.6 or 0.75, 75-25 ratio, or 0.6, 0.40. 60% of the data, we will be using it for training purpose. 40% of the data, we will be using it for testing purpose. Right? But 60% of the data, you have mentioned 60% of the data, we use it for, you know, training purpose. That too you randomly sample from the given data set. The entire data set, data, randomly take the 60% of the data and store it in a variable training. And the remaining 40% of data is test data set. Simple. Don't worry about, you know, how these command under command level, don't get in now. Okay. So look at here. I'll just show you. Actually, as per my agenda, I mentioned about Python, but anyhow, because it's very easy to understand. 148, total number of records, how much? 148. 5 columns are there. Correct. This is the given data. Your manager gave you this one. Now you create training and test set. Your training data set, you need to have 60% of the data, right? 148 into 0.6. Sorry, 1.0, there should not be any there. 88.8 training data, sorry, it should be 0.6, 60% is how much? 60 by 100 is 0.06? No, 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 0.6 only, right? Yeah, 88.8, right? So 88.8, and here 90, two records, you know, additionally, and see, it rounded up 89 and 90, and 148 into 0.4, how much? It's almost 59 records, right? 58 records used. See, test data set, we have 58. It split up the data correctly. That is what I validated here. Training data set, 60% of data is there. Almost 80, 90, and test data set we have 58 records are. Now my training and test data sets are ready. Fine. Next, this is what you need to remember. I use a function called LM function to train my machine learning model. So what is this price? What is this price? Karthik, what is this price?
Price of the house.
No, no, no.
What is?
Yeah, what is the type of variable?
Independent variable.
Price of?
No, sorry, dependent variable.
Ah, dependent variable, right?
Dependent on size.
Yeah, dependent variable, right? So even in Great Lakes, they train you on both R and Python, right? Yeah, what is tilde sign? This is called tilde. In R, this is the syntax, okay? Price, dependent variable. On the left side of the tilde, you need to specify the dependent variable. On the right side of the tilde, you need to specify the independent variable. Here, what I did, I put a dot here. Dot means, except the dependent variable, rest of the variables will be included in my model. That is what this dot is saying. Otherwise, you have to specify, you need to type all these independent variables manually. Here, I have only four independent variables, four features, right? Size plus UDS plus PAR plus MAC. Typing time will not take much time. What if you have 100 features? 100 features you have to type. It's a time taking process. That's the reason why they give you some shortcut, right? Like a dot. If you specify dot, except the dependent variable, rest of the independent variable you include in the model. This is equivalent to this one. Size plus UDS plus PAR plus MISC. This is equivalent to this one. But you don't have to type each and every independent variable. If you specify dot, so in this case I included all the features. So though I could see only the size and UDS, these two variables are significant, right? So I could have removed these two variables, right? We will see what happens. If I include them also, what is going to happen? So now what happened? On the left side of the tilde, dependent variable. Right side of the tilde, you have to specify the independent variables. Fine. The next, you need to tell the data, right? You have training data set is there, test data set is there, housing DF, the entire data is also there. You need to tell your linear regression model which data frame it has to use, right? Training data set. Using the training, you need to use data equal to train. Look here, train, data equal to train, right? Using the training data set, you train the model and store the output of the model in housing.fit. That's all. Now, I'm going to use summary function to display the value stored in my housing.fit. Look here. So, it gives me the formula that I used it in my model. To train my model, it gives me the error, right? 5 number summary for my error residuals, and then intercept size UDS PAR MISC. For what is intercept? Beta naught, right? What are these values? Slopes. Because this is a multiple linear regression. So far I discussed about simple linear regression. What is multiple linear regression? If you include more than one independent variable in your model, we call that as a multiple linear regression. So the equation for the multiple y is equal to beta naught. So here I cannot use the notation beta naught. B0 is nothing but beta naught. You just think that way. Beta 1 is the slope. For which one? Size. And beta 2 is the slope for each and every independent variable. You will have a corresponding slope. So this B1 is nothing but this value. This B2 is nothing but the slope for the UDS. Don't go by the literal name here. Size is nothing but the beta 1 slope value. See, why they mention the independent variable name here is, so if you specify beta 1, beta 2, if that gives right blindly some beta 1, beta 2, from the business point of view, very difficult. Okay, beta 1 is related to size or beta 2 is UDS. Right, interpretation purpose, right, it will be difficult. That's the reason that they specific, instead of saying beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4, they mention the column name itself here, UDS, beta 2 into UDS. Listen very carefully, this is very, very important step, okay. Beta 2 and beta 3 into PARC plus beta 4 into MISC. That's all, this is the equation. If you plug in all the values, you can get the predicted value. You get the predicted value, right? So, but don't, you know, left side you can ignore it. Right side, for the right side you need to plug in all the values, okay? So here, I am going to take this value, 2.99, copy, paste it. This is my beta 0, right? B0 is this one, plus B1. What is B1? 0.047. Listen very carefully. Please concentrate. What is my size? The size, okay, the first value for, let me go to the data set. Housing data, right?
It will be under train summary, right?
Yeah, correct. That. So no point in going there. You are correct. See, I was going there mindlessly there. Okay. See, okay, head of train, let's use no train, let's take only one record, size is 44.5, right, so let me do one thing, here 44.5, first record, okay, plus the second one is beta 2, right, this is the one, and UDS is 39.3, plus next one is PARC. PARC is 0.03152 into first record 45.1, right, plus this one beta 4, am I correct? So 10.398 for this record. The actual value is this one. What is the predicted value? This is the predicted value. If you plug in all the values in this equation, right, you will get the predicted value for each and every record. So in this case, we took the first record of the training data set. For the training data set, the predicted housing price is this one. What is the error now?
0.01.
Excellent, right? This is my actual, this is my predicted. So 10.4 minus,
actually 0 we can say it is 0.3999.
Yeah, almost you know 0 only, right, 0.00002, it is equivalent to 0. So the accuracy is very good in this case, right?
Yes.
So we have something called predict function. We have something called predict function, right? So what I am going to do is, we can predict the training data set itself. So my, what is my model name now? Housing.fit. I train my model using the training data set and I store the model output in a variable called housing.fit. So henceforth I am going to call this one as my model name. So this is my trained model, which one? Housing.fit. I apply this model on the test data set. Before I apply this on the test data set, I will apply this on the training data set itself and we will see what is the predict. We will check whether this one is corrected or not, with our value is correct or not, right? So here I am going to simply say predict housing.fit. Here I am going to say train. 10.44 I edutom 44.5 which 44.5 enga irukku it is not displaying in the correct order right so this is the predictor value sorry second row 10.4 right this is the one predicted value 10.4 for this it rounded it off 10.40 so the actual unpredicted is this is one so we have instead of manually calculating the predicted value for each and every row we can use a predict function the predict function given is in what it does this is what it does purinjada romba simple Karthik, Purilia. No, please, please concentrate here. Okay, don't get me wrong. Okay, when you know 8th standard person, the bank roller, they understood. Actually, only one goaler they understood, because I teach in a very, very you know school student level. See here, what is the equation for linear regression? This is right. I told you the intercept slope will be given by the model automatically. We don't have to compute the value for the slopes beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, beta 4. For all the independent variables, there is a separate slope values will be there. There will be a corresponding slope value will be there. For all the independent variables, the slope is not constant. Like intercept. Intercept is constant. It is common for all the thing, right? So beta 1 is size. And beta 2 is UDS slope, right? In the slope. In the one, the size la vandu first record eduthukitta 44.5. Adhu dhaan eduthukitta inga size ku vandu inga 44.5 used it. Simply I plugged in these values. Guys, please listen very carefully. None of you are responding well, though I explained you in a very layman point of view. Fine. So this is at least Bala, you are able to understand, right? So probably you guys can. Discuss amongst yourself. Okay.
Yeah, Satya, I can able to relate it.
Yeah. Sarnath, I think Sarnath is also not that clear. Or the best thing you can watch my video after this session. See, fine. So I can manually also find out the predicted value for the training data set, even for test data set also by plugging in the value into the equation. Instead of plugging in the values in the equation, I'm using the predict function. Predict function, what it does is. It takes in the predict function. The first argument is you need to specify a model name. What is my model name? Housing dot fit. Comma new data equal to train. So in the train parla, so in practice, enna pannanum, we use the test data set. So that's what I mentioned at the. We already we trained the model. We want to predict the unseen data, the test data set. Because when I train my model, right? When I train my model, I use the training data set. My model did not see the test data set data. When I apply this model which got trained on the training data set on the unseen data, the prediction accuracy should be very good. Okay, so okay, now I'm going to apply this model housing dot fit on the unseen data test data set. Fine. If I enna irukana So I'm going to view my test data set. You have a command called view, view test. So inge ellam kaamichidu. What is price? What is spread? Sarnath, what is price and spread? Or Karthik? Idu vandu test data set. Price is enna?
Independent variable.
Are you sleeping? Yeah, this is actual. This is the predicted.
Price is
actual and predicted value. Karthik, enna achi sleeping actual and predicted, right? Test data la vandu actual, predicted vandu na store pannirukken paarenga. Ena in the test data liye, if I include the predicted value for the corresponding test data record sets, I can compare. So idhiye nama enna pannalana, what I can do is I can include a error column also, right? Error. Here, what I do is test dollar price minus test dollar spread. See, error also in R. The actual mean is predicted. 22.1 minus 20.9 is 1.149. 12.2, see this actual is 9.3. 9.3 minus, sorry, yeah, 22.1 minus this one. So actual minus predicted is error. இதை விட பெட்டராக என்ன பண்ணலாம், இது ஸ்கொயர் பண்ணிடலாம், எரரே ஸ்கொயர் பண்ணிடலாம் இல்லையா. ஸோ வாட் ஐ டூ இஸ் ஐ யூஸ் த சேம் ஈக்குவேஷன், ஐ கால் திஸ் எஸ் யூனோ ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு ஆட் அனதர் காலம் ஐ நோ எரர் ஸ்கொயர். ஸோ ஐம் கோயிங் டு ஸ்கொயர் திஸ் ஒன். Right?
Yes,
yes. Sum of squared error. Right? So now what I am going to do is sum of test dollar error 2. Sum of squared error 179.84. In the error squared, if you add all these values, see the negative value became positive. Right? The negative value, minus 2 into minus 2 will become 4. But the decimal values are there because of which, right? It test dot predict. Yeah, squared. Correct only, right? Actual minus predicted, yeah. So this got squared, okay. Because the price is square, I don't the actual, right? So price minus predicted, that is nothing but your error squared, okay. Okay, in the eighth, no, we don't have to do this one, okay. In the one, then the ஆக்சுவல் மைனஸ் ப்ரிடிக்டட் இருக்கு இல்லையா, அதுதான். ஸோ ஓகே, இங்கே எரர் காலத்தை பண்ணாலே போதும், ஸ்கொயர் பண்ணால் போதும் இல்லையா. டெஸ்ட் டாலர் டாலர் இஆர்ஆர் ஸ்கொயர் இப்படி தான் பண்ணணும். ஐ எம் நாட் சப்போஸ் டூ தட், ஓகே. அதுவும் ஒன்றா, எல்லாம் ஒன்று தான் இல்லையா, கரெக்டாக. ஓகே, ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் தி திஸ் இஸ் ஸ்கொயர்ட் வேல்யூ, தி எரர் இருக்கு இல்லையா, இந்த வேல்யூ ஸ்கொயர் பண்ணியிருக்கோம்.
சத்யா, so it is also, see, the error code, right? I mean the square value of error, it is also multiplied by 100, right? For example, can you scroll up little bit up, please? Okay, sir, send it up. Okay, there was a yeah, line 21, right, is the size, don't scroll, please. Okay, see, if you square that error, right, 0.5562019, when we square it, right, we will get some 0.3, right, 0.3.
Mm.
So then it is multiplied by 100. Then only it is showing the error 2 is right, error square into 100.
Yeah, the e minus 0 when you are talking, right?
Yeah, yeah.
No, e minus,
not that one, actually, say the error, right?
No, wait, 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 Satish.
When I square it, right, we will get 0.03. Sorry, 0.30.
Three. So, correct one, right? 0.03 one, right?
It's multiplied by some other.
Yeah, yeah, 0.03.
Satish, that is what it is putting us e to the power of minus.
Ah, minus 0.1.
So, that is only
0.03, Allah.
Yes.
It is correct only, okay?
Yeah, correct
only. So, error square, right? So, this is how we can compare this one. So, now we have test error square, right? We squared all these values, we need to add all these values. Other badla, what I am doing is, I am doing square root of test dollar error square, right? So, this is the one. What I am going to do is, I am going to do sum of all these values, I am going to add all these values and then I am going to square it. So this is what my root mean square error. I am taking the square root on the sum of all these values. I am going to sum all these values, squared value, sum of squared error, and then I take the square. This is what root mean square error. So yeah, for 13.41 we are getting it. Note it down, this is very important. Okay, next what I am going to do is, so now the question is, okay, if R and S E we obtained it, so what am I going to understand from this, and how do I interpret this? So R and S E is nothing but root mean squared error. It gives me the value for the error, the model error. The model error is 13. So how much less is lesser error, how much more is more error. How do I know that? So for that, what you have to do is, you need to build another model. Okay, you need to train another model. For example, here, That's what I did it here. Look here. So these two variables were not at all significant, right? Because these two variables were not correlated linearly with price, the dependent variable. And there is no point in including them in this model, but we blindly included all the four variables. Now what I am going to do is, I am creating another model called housing.fit1. I am going to apply this housing.fit1 on the test data set. See, in here the formula is put. See, sum of squared error, all these things, square root of all the things, right? The same thing, number in the formula, the input is 15.74. Here 13.4105, we are getting this error, right? So the root mean squared error, we could see that by including all the four features it was coming like this, but after excluding those features were not significant, the model but in this case RMS is not much helpful. So then how do I summary? Okay, this is an extreme case. See, housing.fit summary of housing.fit la pathina now you have something adjusted ask at 0.8971 and housing, let me do one thing, where is that, you need to use this metric 0.8971 here 0.897, both of them are same only, right? It is not, there is not much difference between these two. After including or excluding this, we don't see much difference, right? In this case, because the volume of the data is not much. If your volume of data is more, then you would have seen the difference. See, I was talking about the p-value, you remember? Okay, now let us shift our focus here. Okay, let us shift our focus here. These are all my independent variables. Instead of blindly including all the four independent variables, I include only these two independent variables. Why? Because I included all the four independent variables by specifying dot sines, UDS, park, MASE. Along with this, you will find the p-value here. Instead of seeing p-values, right, wherever you see a star, triple star, double star, single star, along with the variable, that means those variables are statistically significant. Okay? Look here, this p-value is nothing but 0, right? E2E minus 16 and 0.15 zeros, 0.000002, which is nothing but 0 only. See, the p-value is less than alpha. Hence, you reject the null hypothesis and you conclude size is statistically significant variable, which means including size does make sense in this model. Similarly, UDS. But here you don't see any star. That means these two variables are not significant. Not at all helpful, but still we can see the even after excluding that variable, right? So we are getting, you might be arguing, Satya, still we see this value, right? Right, so then one second, yeah, more or less it is same only, right? Multiple R squared is 0.90 here. Adjusted R squared by me. So in the interview they will ask you what is R squared. Multiple ask you nothing but R squared, okay? Adjusted R squared 0.897. But one difference here is when you include,
can you repeat that? What is that multiple R squared means?
Which is nothing but R squared. I'll explain you R squared, what exactly R squared later, okay? You don't worry too much, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So because so this has some formula
under the formula, right? Formula equal to price tilde size plus UDS, that you said that independent variable. So from right side. Okay? So initially you are mentioning about is the tilde, we kept tilde before the variable and it called as an independent variable. Okay, and if it is we put after variable, then it is dependent variable, right? So in the formula, no, the next formula, summary housing that fit one. So in this correct, right? So I will make sure whether it's independent or dependent, because it's the tilde is after price and before the size.
No, okay, to answer to your question, what is there before tilde? What variable is there?
It's an independent variable. size and duration.
No, not you see, after tilde is size and duration. Before tilde, what is there?
Price is there.
What is price we have? Now you tell me what is there, you know, this prayer before this one.
No, I got this, Satya. My question is, right, so whatever that you put in the next formula, right, so you will consider that before till day it's a different variable, after
exactly.
Till day it's a different.
Correct.
It is not, the till day is not specific to that any variable, but it will consider that whatever is a till day after a variable after till day, then it will be a
after tilde, whatever variable that you specify it, right? Those are all called your independent variables.
For
the sake of others, I
repeat,
right?
So, we mentioned only one tilde. So, whether you consider it will take for size and UDS or price, but I got it now.
Yeah, the reason why I reiterated, right? For the sake of others, also I reiterated. So, anything after tilde, if you specify, right? Size plus, UDS plus, par plus, MISE, those are all called independent variables. Anything before tilde is specific, called a dependent variable. So this is the basic thing. Now you understood. Good. All of you are able to understand, right? So next step is, we have something called R square. Forget about multiple R square. Okay, it's nothing but R square only, right? The R square value will get inflated when you include more number of variables. In the case of simple linear regression, what do you mean by simple linear regression? In the case of simple linear regression, you will have to use only one independent variable. That is called simple linear regression. In the case of simple linear regression, we look at only the R square. But in real time scenario, are we going to use only one independent variable? No, right? Multiple linear regression only we are going to use it. But interview question, online test, you should be knowing, right? So that's the reason why when you use simple linear regression, you use R square only. Okay, but when you will be using R square metric. That means, if the higher the R square, better the model. Similarly, higher the adjusted R square, better the model. But when you use simple linear regression, you don't have to look at adjusted R square. You look at only the R square. I'll explain you what is R square and all. Don't worry too much now. Okay? Let's go step by step. In the case of simple linear regression, which metric you use it? Apart from R and SE, you will have to look at this one, R squared only, not adjusted R squared, okay? But since we are using more than one independent variable, we have to look at adjusted R squared metric only. So 0.897 is somewhat closer to 1. That means it is good, it is not bad, the model is good. But any value of adjusted R squared or R squared is closer to 1, the better the model. Let's say you are on-site peer, the American, right, data scientist, senior data scientist, is a difficult to crack. He tells you, no man, I'm not convinced with this one. Why don't you increase it to 0.95? Do something and you know improve it, because you want higher accuracy. I don't know what you do, but again, it depends on the volume of the data. So if the volume of the data is not that good, right? The accuracy, you cannot get more, and also depends on the pattern of the data also. But see, we try to improve this one also, okay? But in this case, even after, why we drop these two variables? Because these two variables are not at all significant. Even in this correlation matrix also, we saw both park and MI is nowhere helpful. It is not at all linearly correlated price. This is just, because of coincidence, right? This value is somewhat closer to this one, 0.8. So these two model accuracy are same, but here if you look at the R squared value, it blindly inflated the value, right? Though these two variables are not significantly blindly inflated. So, but here we discarded the R squared is 0.894 only, but you need to use adjusted R squared. The reason why we are using adjusted R squared, they will ask you in the interview. So why do you have to use adjusted R squared in the case of multiple linear regression? Why can't I use R squared? The reason is the adjusted R square, look here, there is a difference between R squared and adjusted R squared, even in this model itself, right? The adjusted R squared is, lesser, always lesser than, most of the cases it will be lesser than your R squared value only. The reason is, the adjusted R squared penalizes, though you include, multiple independent variables, it penalizes the variables that are not at all significant. I will give you one analogy. Let's say your manager, senior manager gave you 10 resources to you. Hey, I gave you 10 people. Why you are not able to complete it in 2 days time? So you go back and tell him, boss, you gave me 10 people, but only 2 people have the knowledge. Remaining 8 people, they don't know anything about data science. Right? But your account manager will think, hey, I gave 10 people, right? But you are going to tell him, of these 10 people, only these, only this is the rating I can give. Something like that. You just relate with it. Maybe it's a crude example. But hope this one helped you to understand, sir. So you are going to penalize the non-performers. So these people are non-performers, right? So what is the point in giving 10 people? Only 2 people are doing it. So, but you will exaggerate. Your senior man say, hey, I give you 10 people. So blindly will increase the productivity. But you will say, no, the productivity is only this much. After penalizing. So the adjusted R squared penalizes the features that are not significant. And then you have your statistic and p-value. So p-value and your statistic, right? So your statistic value should be less. Or especially the p-value. If the p-value is less than alpha, then you reject the method. See, the f-statistic, what it tells you is, overall, with the given all the 4 features, how well my model is doing it. Or, in other words, f-statistics tells us, at least of the 4 independent variables, some variables are helpful to fit the model. That is what f-statistic tells. The p-value says yes. So here what is the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis is none of the features are significant. What is the alternative hypothesis? At least one of the features is significant, right? Since the p-value is less than alpha, you reject the null hypothesis and say at least one of the features or one or more than one features are significant, right? From the high level, right? When you look at f-statistic and p-value is less than alpha, that means at least few of the independent variables are helpful in terms of predicting the model, right? So in both the cases, the same value we are getting it, but here the f-statistic is more here, but at the end of the day, the p-value is less than alpha only. Right, and the standard residual standard 1.577, it's more or less same only, but 85 degrees only, 87 degrees of freedom, and multiple R square here it is less because we excluded those two non-significant features. But end of the day, you need to look at this one only. Okay, you need to compare these two models. RMSE, of these two models, whichever models RMSE is better, but there is a what do you say, so there is a some kind of contraindication here, right? So though these two variables are not significant, even after eliminating this, the adjusted R squared is same only. So it is, but most of the cases, right, when you eliminate the insignificant variables from your model accuracy will be good when you after eliminating the insignificant features. But this is just very rare case you will get like this. So with this, what you understand, we cannot simply go by the one second, let me just use this one here. This is for this is for test dollar spread, right? Okay, one second, test dollar spread, and that is for 15.74. And where is that one? The Okay, I did not use for that one, right? One second, that's the problem. Sorry, where is the fit one? Housing fit one. Okay, I will use here itself. See, what is test dollar bread? And test dollar bread and test dollar price, right? So test dollar bread is holding the housing fit dot fit model's predicted value. Where is housing dot fit one's predicted value? Where did we store? We did not store, right? Are you concentrating or not? See, I have used to two different. Okay, I
used. Yeah, but we execute as fit one only, right?
No, fit one. But test dollar bread. But here, I did not use this. Well, so I should have used different notation here. Bread one. See, this value overwritten the older value. The what is that? The housing dot fit model's predicted value. We store it in a variable called bread. And again, when you use fit one to predict the test data set, and if you store it in the same variable, what will happen? That one will be overwritten, right? Yeah, that
is over.
That is what I did a mistake here. Yeah, what I do is I'm going to. That's the reason why it was showing more. Let me see what happens here. Usually it will come like this. Bread one, right? Here I should have used the actual values. Sorry, the actual values. Okay, don't get confused, this is the actual value. You can write it this way also because we are storing it, right? The actual value predict minus predicted value. Actual value. Actually, this one supposed to be, this one supposed to be here. Let me just see what value am I going to get here. 15.74. In this case, how much I got? 15.7. Both the cases we are getting same.
Actually, I have a doubt here, Satya, because it's data varies, right? We need to change it as train or do we need to
one second. Okay. Let me just re-execute it. Right. So now the fit one is on the training data set. One second, you know. So here so this is the test bread one and predicted value of fit. Okay. Now just give me a second. I'll just print one and bread one, right? Yeah. So these two things we will check it out. Yeah, that's what I was wondering. So can someone tell me what is this value and what is this value? This is a root mean square, don't tell me. Root mean square error for which model? Which model? Very good.
Test.
Exactly, very good, right? Housing dot fit. For this model, the root mean square error is this one. That's what I was wondering. I made a mistake here, okay? So what is this? This root mean square error is related to my other model, housing dot second model.
Second one is our training data. With the ID.
No, sorry.
Significant data.
One second.
With only significant data.
Second model with only the significant features.
Data.
First model you blindly included.
With all the data.
Since you included all the columns blindly, independent variable, the error was 16. But in the second model, you included only the significant features, hence the error fallen down, right? Drop down. So of these two models, which one is better? Satish or Karthik, you tell me. Bala, you keep quiet. Or Sarnath. Prakash, are you there? Sudeep? They did not join at all. See, we have two models here. Once again, I will, you know, delete all these things so that you should not get confused. Yeah, it's correct only, right? See, what I did.
15.74.
No, Karthik.
Because it is closer to 1.
No, don't get. I think you are not concentrating here. Karthik. We are not talking about adjusted R square. Adjusted R square only we should, the value of adjusted R square should be closer to 1. But RMSE need not to be closer to 1. But here, Karthik, you tell me how many models I created. Karthik or Satish?
Yeah, two models, train and test.
Yeah. No, not two models, train and test. Listen very carefully. One model housing dot fit.
Yeah, okay,
other model is housing dot fit one. right? I'll just copy and paste it here, okay?
And with the two data, I'm saying that the train data and the test data, yeah. Right? So we are using housing fit, dark fit and housing dot fit one, and housing.fit
you
are using.
Yeah, so housing.fit, one second, housing.fit model, I included all the independent variables blindly.
Blind, yes.
Right? And then I applied this model on the test data set.
Mm.
Right? And then I computed the RMSE. For this model, the RMSE is this one. And then what I did, in this model, I realized, man, I blindly included all the independent variables. Because size plus u is only these two variables are significant. Karthik, Purinjada? Karthik, are you able to understand? Size plus u is. Because look here, logically, in the size so u is only these two variables are correlated well with this one, right? Price. These two, Pramark and MIC, were not correlated well here. There is no correlation. Hence, I removed it. So I fitted another model. This is model 1, this is model 2. Model 2 RMSE is 15.74. You need to note it down. Model 1's RMSE is this one. Or these two models, housing.fit1 outperforms. Because the error is less. The lesser the error, better the accuracy. But when I use the summary function, right? Housing dot summary of housing dot adjusted basket, when I look at it, 0.8971. But when I use summary housing.fit1 also, I get 0.8971. But it is kind of confusing, right? Both of them are same. But of these two, then what is the point in removing these two variables? That is where RMS is coming into picture. Sorry, I was, I made a mistake. I have overwritten this variable, right? That is the reason why confusion happened. I created one more variable. The PRED1 column holds housing.fit1 model's predicted value. The PRED column holds the housing.fit model's predicted value, right? So now this one is good. So what I will do is, I will just share this script also. You just take it. It's a very simple one. But don't, get into too much of, this and all you can, skip it, okay? Data set also I will send it. You can execute it and, you can check it, right? Don't get into too much of syntax thing. I'll walk you through step by step the syntax part. Don't worry now. Fine. So which are metrics that we looked at? It we looked at adjusted R square for these two models. Both of them are same, but we are inconclusive comparing these two models adjusted R square, because both of them are same. When we used adjusted R square, the RMSE, we understood, okay, of these two models, the housing.fit one, which has only the statistically significant independent variables, right? The RM error is less. That is what I mentioned it here. The sub feature selection, right? In the case of feature selection, unnecessary predictors will add noise to the estimation. What is noise? Error. The data scientists, they will keep on using this term, noise, signal. Signal, you have some pattern. Actually, signal should be there, but noise should not be there, right? After, by when you blindly including all these things, right? So that's what he's saying. Unnecessary predictors will add noise to the estimation, other one that we are interested in. So hence, you have to remove the unnecessary predictors. Okay, next question is, sir, you said something called step function. Okay, step function, enna pandrana, housing.fit la ella column use pandran, yeah? Blindly, I used all the columns. Supposing, see, in the case la nammalku rendu variable undu significant inga star star irukku paathu pottom righta. Okay, if I have 100 features dot vechalum nammalku enna avum, it's very difficult to find out, right, which all column should be included. I will leave that with my step function. Step inside the parenthesis, you need to specify the model name. So in this model, I'm using all the independent variables. And let's see what happens. See, finally, it suggests me, this is the recommended model. The last line in your step function is your recommended model. This is the one recommended by whom? Step function. Using step function also, we can do feature selection. However, with step-wise regression also, there are some disadvantages are there. We cannot completely rely on step-wise regression also. We will discuss that in tomorrow's session, okay? The drawbacks with this one. And also tomorrow, I will demonstrate the same in Python. Okay, and then I'll explain you the rationale for what is R squared, what is adjusted R squared. In the interview, they'll ask you the formula for adjusted R squared, everything, okay? Look here, I mentioned everything in detail here. It is an estimated mean y value and when all x's are 0. What is intercept? This is the estimated crossing rate. All these things are available as a document in my website. Yeah, I created a link also. I will share the link also right after the session, okay, for the study material, everything. And also, you know, we are keep updating the blogs in our website also, one after another, right? We keep sharing it to you all. You just, you know, you don't rely only on my study material. And also you can cross reference those blog contents also, okay? So here I mentioned the output, how to interpret the model output. The interview, they will give you some model. See, they will give you something like this, okay? They will give you something like this and then they will ask you to interpret it. What is intercept? What is size and UDS, right? And it is an estimated mean value, mean y value when all x's are 0. That is what intercept. This is the estimated effect of housing. This is the estimated effect of housing price, housing size on price. What is the estimated effect of size on my housing price? In other words, right, we can say that too. So multiple R squared, and then what does this three star, double star, single star test? This under we'll see tomorrow. Okay. Right, all these things, you know, see intercept and also I mentioned with example. If the size, see, this is what we are getting it, right? Okay, let's say the intercept value is 3.0074 and the size is, the slope for size is this one and the slope for UDS is this one, right? How do we interpret from the business point of view? If the size of the house is 0, you would expect the housing price is 3.007. This is very pretty straightforward, right? Size quotient 0.04 is there. If the size of the house increases by 1 unit or 1 square foot, the housing price is expected to increase by 0.04, holding the other variables constant. In this case, we have only UDS. And similarly, UDS, if the housing price, if the underwrite share increases by 1 square foot, the housing price expected to increase by 0.1797 by holding other independent variables constant. This is how you need to interpret, okay, from the business point of view. As a data scientist, okay, you must be asking what is standard error, and especially when you use Python, the Python's OLS function is there, okay. With that OLS function, it gives you exhaustive information like this. What is omnibus, probability, on everything I mentioned here, okay? Fine. So we will discuss the Python part tomorrow, how to implement the model in Python. I will discuss it tomorrow. In addition to that, I will complete the validating the assumptions, linear regression model assumptions, like linearity and the normality of the residuals, and we have something called multicollinearity, okay? And then heteroscedasticity, homoscedasticity, all those things we'll discuss it. Don't worry about all these terms. See, honestly speaking, okay. So the second model predicted this value for this one, size and UDS, right? And okay, the next one is, I was trying to relate this. Okay, one second, let me, we can plot it also. Okay, so you know, so see, confidence interval, you have something called confidence interval, right? Confident of, let me go for confident of your this one, housing dot fit one. See, you might be asking this question, right? So for example, Satya, I, for this specification, your model predicted, second model predicted the housing price as 20.71. So is this same for all the months, all the year? That is the confidence interval use model. We have something called confident, right? Confident use model. You remember confidence interval we discussed as part of inferential statistics. Range of values we give, right? the range of values. So the size, the confidence interval for the intercept. The intercept is slope. For example, okay, sorry, I should have told this one earlier. Where is that table? I showed you that one, the 1 unit increase in that one, right? I was in price. Delete another. I somehow deleted it, this one. So look here. So this is the one, intercept size. So you must be asking, your manager must be asking this one. So if the size of the house increased by 1 square foot, the expected housing price to the expected increase in house price will be 0.04. So you will be asking this question. The expected increase in the house price is 0.04 for all the months or for all the year. No, this is a constant value. In that case, smartly are giving them some range of values, which is nothing but confidence interval. There is a predefined, pre-built function, confidence is already available. Just pass the model. So with this, you can tell him it is not 0.04. There is a one unit increase in the square feet. Would expect the housing price will increase anywhere between these two values. Purunjada? Instead of saying 0.04, see the average age, you remember, right? We discussed about average age. You took one sample, and if you tell him the population average is also 22 from a Indian empire, but different model have different average age, right? So for that, maybe they include something range of values. I gave you this example also, right? If your manager asks you tomorrow what time you can come, you don't tell him the point estimate value, because he is very particular. If you say tomorrow 10:50 AM I will come, he will keep checking his watch, right? So you will tell him then I will come anywhere between 10 to 10:45. Same in the confidence interval also we are using it here. I think you guys have to revise whatever I covered so far, right? The inference study also, please review it one more time. But this is very important. So we will continue Python tomorrow. In the meanwhile, tomorrow daytime, you are completely free. One way it is good having this session at night time, because you have lot of time to review my video and the script, okay? But this is very important topics, right? The machine learning, don't miss any sessions. See, you believe me or not, one guy, they are not willing. Fine, with this I'm going to wrap up. We will continue the session tomorrow, okay? Anyhow, tomorrow also I'll give you a quick recap of this one at an high level, okay? So that you will be more focused on that, okay? Because tomorrow in Python I will give you a demo. Don't worry too much on the syntax of the things. That you will learn it over a period of time. I will also walk you through that, okay? Don't worry. Tomorrow probably I will finish up that also, okay? See, here I have used something called a set dot seed use money, you know. I did not use it, right? Okay. Use something called seed function. I will explain that one also tomorrow. Okay, set dot seed. That you should be knowing it. Okay, set dot seed. I will just put it here. Set dot seed of, let's say, 100 or something like that. Okay. So why I use set dot seed here is the training and test data set. When you rerun this script multiple times, because the create data partition, what it does is randomly it samples the 60% of the data, right? Each and every when the training data will differ. I don't want that to happen. Even if I execute this command multiple times, each time the same randomly sampled value gets stored in training data set. For that purpose we are using set.seed function. Android you can specify any value, but make sure that you are specifying the value somewhat lesser than your total number of records in your data set. That's all. Right? Because in Python there is an equivalent command for this. There is a different command is available. The only difference is commands, that's all, the syntax, nothing else. Okay. This is very important. Today's session is very important. don't miss out.